Quorum being present, this town meeting is called to order. Mr. LaLasher, I turn the meeting over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. We can first have the Pledge of Allegiance from our special guest this morning.
And to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I actually wrote down remarks for, I think, the first time in my life, Bill. Bill, tonight we gather to commemorate your 50th year.
How's this?
Bill, tonight we gather to commemorate your 50th year as a town meeting member, and because we were posted to meet. My recollection of 1967 is shown on the slide behind, when I was a very, 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 very little boy. And that's when I began to follow a local baseball team. What I remember most is Dick Williams saying, "We'll win more than we lose," and that began the impossible dream season. So too began a very similar adventure here in Reading. While less well known outside our community, your contributions over the years are far greater than any accomplishment on any baseball diamond anywhere. Before we begin the program, which probably will last several hours, by the way, I do want to offer hearty congratulations from our three legislators that could not be here tonight. They're busy doing the people's work, trying to balance a budget, as we will be doing next Monday. Senator Jason Lewis, Representatives Brad Jones and Jim Dwyer do plan to come to a future selectmen's meeting and honor your accomplishment of 50 years. Before I turn the microphone over to some of our speakers, I want to offer you two small gifts on behalf of the town. The first is something usually reserved only for our longest-serving employees upon retirement. Now, in the private sector, one gets very lavish gifts, not so much here. And you're like an employee to us because you're at town hall almost as much as the rest of us. So here's your first gift, Bill. If there was room, it would have said or else. In keeping with the theme, I have another very small but very special gift I think you'll really enjoy. The slide behind me shows how we honored Ted Williams' home run by painting a seat red in Fenway. I have a little plaque that Facilities is going to put on your seat. The plaque reads, "Reserved for Bill Brown." We thought of painting the seat red, but I was overruled. I know it will cause many future discussions about your legacy. I thought it would also be helpful as you got older to remind you where you belong. I also have some flowers from town meeting as a whole that I'll present. I would like to thank Executive Assistant Caitlin Saunders for her work on the following presentations. Firefighter and bagpiper extraordinaire John Keogh up in the back, as well as our honor guard under the leadership of Lieutenant John McKenna for joining us tonight. As they depart, with the permission of the moderator, I'd like to turn the ceremony over to former town meeting member Fred Van Magnus.
First of all, I think everybody should just sit back and relax and take a seat. Thank you. It is indeed with a great deal of pleasure that I have the opportunity to stand before Reading's town meeting once again to honor Bill Brown on this very, very special celebration tonight, surpassing 50 years as Reading's town meeting member. I got a call this morning from Bill to tell me about his recent trip to North Carolina. It was a little bit of a difficult conversation because as part of it, he talked a little bit about town meeting on Monday night. And then he said, I don't know, he said, there's something going on, some special speaker or something happening tonight. I said, beats me, I'm not going to be around at home. I decided to come here, Bill. Frankly, Bill has been a town meeting member probably longer than folks that are sitting here in this room have been alive. When his daughter Darcy spoke to him Tuesday, she asked if they had played Hail to the Chief for Bill on Monday. According to Darcy, Bill said no, and he seemed very disappointed. Well, Bill, tonight is your Hail to the Chief. This moment has been secretly planned with Darcy, your daughter Darcy, Stephen, Sarah, town officials, and others for quite a while now, all along keeping you very much in the dark. With Bill, there is really so much material from his 50 years of service, it is very hard to pick just a few highlights, but I will try. Bill first started his quest for a town meeting seat in Precinct 8, a historically difficult precinct in which to win a place in town meeting back in the late 1950s. As a matter of fact, according to Bill, it took him 9 elections before he actually won that coveted seat. I often wonder what those folks were thinking about back then and why it took them so long to finally elect Bill. But in 1967, Bill finally won and was officially sworn in as a Reading Town Meeting member. For more than 17 additional election cycles, the folks in Precinct 8 reelected him over and over. According to Bill, he was never the top vote getter, but he never was the lowest either. Throughout all these years, Bill has educated himself in the operation of town meeting, become an outspoken local resource on Robert's Rules of Order. I'm sure you've heard that a number of times here at town meeting. Periodically driving various town council nuts along the way, and through it all worked to make town meeting a continuing vibrant local legislative body. He was actively involved in the town charter commission and its recent redo, as well as serving many times as his precinct's chairman, a member of the rules committee of town meeting, cemetery board of trustees, RMLD commissioner, and numerous study committees. Bill used to boast that because of his years of town meeting experience, he knew where a lot of the dead bodies in town were buried. And I guess that's why the Board of Selectmen took it to heart when they appointed him to the Cemetery Board of Trustees to finish the job and supposedly keep him out of their hair. In case you somehow missed it, Bill is usually a fiscal conservative and an outspoken critic of attempts by anyone to spend money and increase taxes without knowing all of the relevant facts. Bill is renowned for doing his research and digging up details to spur discussion. And you had better have your facts right when debating with Bill. He's the first to point out the differences between a Proposition 2.5 override and a debt exclusion. There is a difference. Past efforts to argue against tax increases have earned him from the local newspaper the moniker of Mr. Malcontent. According to Webster's, a person who can be dissatisfied, rebellious, a mischief maker, sometimes making trouble, an agitator. That seems to fit Bill fairly well, I think. As a matter of fact, however, Bill must have really liked that malcontent label because in several Reading Town directories, he listed his official occupation as agitator, the one and only in Reading and probably the state. Our town clerk had many discussions with Bill over that subject and changing it, and I think she did finally win, is that correct? Okay. One thing that can always be said of Bill, he is unwavering in his attempts to win support for his positions. As a town meeting member, he was always very principled. He will never, unless he's changed his stripes since I was here, he will never vote to move the question because he thinks that's really cutting off debate too much and people should have their right to make their say, and will often call for quorum counts to see if town meetings should be canceled due to lack of attendance, to name a few of his favorite little maneuvers over there in the aisle seat. No matter what is going on, it is likely you will see Bill around town. When his loving wife Barbara died from Lou Gehrig's disease, Bill stepped up in her memory and took it upon himself to collect cans and bottles all year long to obtain the deposits to pay for bottled water for the ALS Angel Fund annual walk around the lake. And he can be seen there every year passing out water to walkers, his way of giving of himself. When asked why he didn't provide ice for cold water, his response was typical Bill. My grandson served overseas to fight for your freedom. If he can drink warm water, so can you. And Bill's devotion to veterans is unwavering. As you know, for years, geraniums have been placed at our veterans' graves for Memorial Day. When the town stopped funding this effort a number of years ago, Bill stepped forward and recruited Kyle McFadden to help raise an endowment fund to fill the need. And I believe they raised close to $85,000 for that effort, which has sustained the flowers on the graves for the past 17 years, which I think is just absolutely a tremendous accomplishment by Bill. But not only that, he was concerned that the flowers were tipping over on the graves with wind. So he came up with a design, and he went over and met with the folks at Northeast Regional Vocational School and had created 600 or more special holders to keep the geraniums from blowing over. And he did that with repurposing aluminum sign material he salvaged from the Bancroft Avenue tennis courts as part of his roaming around the town to make sure things were going well. I had an interesting chat with Bill a couple of weeks ago when he was reminiscing about his time at town meeting. Bill and I do often talk. Those chats are absolutely interesting. Bill brings things up like, do you know how many cracks there are in the new library retaining wall due to dry concrete poured on a hot day? Really? Do you know that the design of the library interior railings means they're not going to last long? Do you know we spend extra money to have those fancy traffic lights on West Street and the darn black paint peeled because they were not supposed to be installed north of the Mason-Dixon line? Now, that's a piece of trivia everybody should know. And how about those fancy brick crosswalks on Main Street or the bollards we spend thousands of dollars on? Then there is Bill's longstanding personal crusade to sell vacant town property, particularly the lots over here on Oakland Road, and his constant vigilance, you saw it tonight, on how the American flag is flown and displayed. And then there was a very interesting meeting a while back at RMLD that I happened to be at to discuss the hiring process for a temporary general manager. When a selectman from another town wanted to take part in the process, Bill just came out point blank and informed him that if he wanted to say, his town should buy their share of the RMLD. Otherwise, Reading owns it, and it'll be our say. It is safe. Remember that, Bill? It is safe to say that there is no tent that Bill Brown cannot find a way to get his nose under and offer an opinion. One thing his daughter Darcy always remembered her dad saying was, if they don't want my opinion, they can stop sending me a tax bill. But let's not be naive and think that that would really stop him from adding his 2 cents worth. No wonder he has a nickname of Mr. Malcontent. In a recent chat, Bill mentioned that he really liked a particular town meeting member who was a former FinCom chairman and a longtime Board of Selectmen member. Bill felt that he was always very conservative, and you know, that was a nice similarity with Bill, until he was appointed to the school building committee. And then, according to Bill, he wasn't all that conservative anymore, and it was lots of spending of money. Not to name names, Russ. I thought, how interesting. Bill has always been the ultimate conservative at town meeting. But when he got appointed to the cemetery board of trustees, he also became a building spender himself with his plan for a new cemetery garage. So was it a case of Bill calling the kettle black? He and I have gone a lot of rounds on that one topic. When I opposed his preferred garage location at Forest Glen, my preferred location was New Crossing Road, he knew right where my family lot was along his proposed new garage entrance road, and he said I better get with the program, or he would have the crews from the cemetery plow all of the road snow right onto my grave lot. I mean, I can't even rest in peace when I get there. Indeed, my agitator friend Bill. By the way, Bill's probably one of the largest landowners in Laurel Hill Cemetery, with dozens and dozens of burial lots under his name, maybe a couple reserved for his friends. Oh, do you have that many friends, Bill? I didn't think so. So if you need a lot, check with Bill and see if you're on his friends list. Speaking of cemeteries, when Bill and I get into one of our frequent debates, he often reminds me that I had better behave myself or he will have the National Guard return with their trucks and their smelly exhaust pipes and haul another 400 yards of compost material around town by driving right in front of my house, just like he did for filling up the Wood End Cemetery. We couldn't breathe on Franklin Street for days on end, but Bill got that job done for free. All fun aside tonight, we mark this very special occasion of Bill's 50 years of elected town meeting membership, a mark that has never been reached by anyone else and which may stand as a record for many, many years to come. I suspect Bill will continue to run for re-election again and again to add to that yearly tally, probably to ensure that nobody will ever come close. His next goal may well be to hold the record as the first 100-year-old town meeting member. And you know, I kind of bet that he might make it. After all, it's only 4 more short election cycles away. While we are celebrating Bill's 50th anniversary, I believe we are here to also celebrate the character of a man who constantly displays the traits of civility, friendship, honesty, patriotism, love of family and his faith, loyalty and personal friendship and respect that actually define the man. How nice it is to have an honest debate with Bill on almost any subject. And when you think that the disagreement may seem deep, he will end the conversation by saying, "You're entitled to your opinion. I don't agree with it, but you're still my friend." So often we lose sight of this simple act of graciousness, but it really typifies the character of the proud and honest man Bill is, and we can all learn a lesson from him. Without a doubt, nobody can honestly say that Bill is not a good and honorable man. As our town manager recently said of Bill, in all his public dealings, what is best for the community is Bill's sole policy objective. done with sustained grace and civility at all times. With Bill, nobody could ask for more or expect less. And it is obvious that voters saw these same traits in re-electing him for 17 terms. Bill has been a remarkable resident of Reading for all but the first three early years of his life, and a friend who will always hold a special place in our hearts for his love and devotion to such a worthwhile endeavor, the ongoing success of this fine town of Reading that he loves so deeply. And Bill, I'd like to ask you if you'd just come up here for a moment, please. And to ensure that he is properly identified in public, I have a little gift to memorialize this occasion with a special thanks to Reading's own coach, Mark Daugherty of Dynamic Sports, for his very helpful assistance and personal desire to share in this project.
There it is. You can be your own official Reading Rock. But Bill.
Somehow we had a little extra ink. In closing, just before we move on to the rest of the program, there's one person who is, and Bill's got a lot of special family members who are indeed very, very close to Bill, and love of family is one of the things that's so important to Bill and his family. I got a nice note from his daughter, Darcy, in North Carolina this morning, who wasn't able to be here. But I just would like to read it. It's very short. She says, "I am so grateful for all of you. This will be such an amazing highlight of Dad's accomplishments. To so many, he is an opinionated, cranky man. Well, he's that to me and much more. He's a man of honor, courage, and integrity. He always did what was necessary to provide for his family. I just get the privilege of calling him Dad." Thank you. Now it was a great deal of pleasure, Bill. We're not done, so there's more to come. Now it is with a great deal of pleasure that I introduce to you Bill's grandson, Stephen Hildreth, who will share some very special Bill Brown memories from the family. And thank you very, very much for allowing me to be here. Thank you.
Well, before I begin, I just want to take a quick moment to thank everyone who helped with my grandfather's presentation. I know my family, who is seated here in the front row. My Uncle Dan is here. My Aunt Donna, my fiance Christina, and my sister Sarah are all very appreciative of your help. I want to send out special thanks to the town moderator, Alan Folds, town meeting, Board of Selectmen, Chairman John Arena, town manager, Bob Lasher, and administrative assistant, Caitlin Saunders. Fred, thank you for your nice words, but just remember my grandfather's motto, never get mad, get even, and the cat's out of the bag. And anyone else has had a hand in making this possible. I hope these slides we're going to go through show my grandfather as we know him, as the family. As my mother, Fred said earlier through my mother's words, as a devoted, caring, and loving family man, while providing a few laughs in between. So we'll start with the early years. And if you know, just shortly after the extinction of the dinosaurs, he is pretty old. Bill has lived in Reading for all but 3 years of his life, growing up at 33 Mount Vernon Street, now residing at 28 Martin Road. Bill is seen here with his 1936 Ford, which he purchased for $100. He will proudly tell anyone who will listen that the car is now buried below the Home Depot on Walkers Brook Drive in the old dump. Bill attended Parker Junior High School and then graduated from the Medford Vocational School. Now we're going to look at his life as a veteran. Bill joined the United States Air Force, serving two tours in Tripoli, Libya during the Korean War. During his 3 years, 11 months, and 17 days in the Air Force, but who's counting, Bill earned the National Service Medal and the Good Conduct Medal. Who would believe Bill could receive the Good Conduct Medal? Here's his DD-214 for proof. Bill is proud of his veteran status as a veteran. Bill continues to support and frequently gather the local scuttlebutt. He proudly displays the American flag he received from his grandson, Brad, who served in the Marine Corps in front of his house. This flag was flown in Afghanistan. Now we're going to look at Bill as a husband. Bill met his wife Barbara on a blind date in 1952. He would ask Barbara to be his wife on December 24th, 1953. Bill and Barbara were married on November 14th, 1954 at the Congregational Church in Woburn. In the first years of their marriage, Bill and Barbara lived in their first house at the intersection of Pearl Street and Charles Street, as Bill, his father, brother, and friends all built his current house at 28 Martin Road. He built that house with his bare hands from the ground up. Barbara and Bill celebrated their 25th wedding anniversary on November 14th, 1979. And this isn't in the slide, but I remarked as I was making this picture in the background of the deer, that hung in the house for a long time, even when I was a kid. So that picture's pretty old. Throughout the years, Bill and Barbara loved vacationing in Bermuda. However, one year, Bill tried to schedule an anniversary vacation around town meeting. Barbara told him not to worry about next year's anniversary vacation if he was that worried, as there would not be a next year. Bill came to his senses. I think he missed town meeting that year. You're welcome, town meeting. Now we're going to look at Bill as his father. Bill is the proud father to his three children, Dan, Donna, and Darcy. Bill was his son Dan's Boy Scout master for Troop 732 in Reading for many years. Bill was recognized throughout the years for his continued dedication to the Boy Scouts of America, serving as Cub Master. Bill has seven grandchildren: Brad, Brian, Stephen, Brendan, Cameron, Sarah, and Neil. Bill is even more fortunate to be the great-grandfather of Samantha, Seth, and Eli. Throughout their lives, Bill and Barbara have always been proud grandparents, taking joy in the many wonderful accomplishments of their grandchildren. Every year, the family would gather at Bill and Barbara's home for a Thanksgiving dinner, where Barbara would make sure that there was a dish for everyone to enjoy. She was the chef, trust me. Here, Bill is enjoying time with his grandsons, Neil, Brad, and Brian, at Brian's wedding. Bill is smiling for this photo with his grandson Cameron and son Dan. And these are Bill's grandchildren, Sarah, Brendan, and Stephen. Bill and his favorite granddaughter, Sarah, she's the only granddaughter. That's why she's the favorite. Now we'll get into his charitable work. Every year, Bill generously donates his time to handing out waters to walk participants at the Angel Fund ALS Walk in Wakefield, Mass., in memory of his late wife, Barbara. Don't ask for a cold water, though, as Fred said earlier, because there are none. As Bill likes to say, if my grandson can drink warm water in the deserts of Iraq serving this country, you can too. In 2010, Bill was given an award by the Angel Fund for his continued support, getting named the Unsung Hero, receiving his award from Richard Kennedy, president of the Angel Fund. Bill was recognized for his continued support in finding a cure for ALS. Bill and his team Nana's Bananas at the annual ALS walk throughout the years. Now we're looking at throughout the years. Pupper always loves to enjoy having all the families over individually to cook a nice pot of pasta and sauce. That's when everything goes on sale and he has a coupon, probably. Pupper's Place of Pasta proves just about anyone who call themselves a cook. Bill's favorite place to get fried clams is the Clam Box in Ipswich. All other restaurants are second best. Don't try to debate it with him. He won't hear anything else. It's only the Clam Box. And you got to get there before 11:30 when they open. Apparently, even back then, you give Bill a microphone in the audience, and he'll make sure his opinion is heard, whether you want it or not. Bill and talent manager Bob LaLasher, he always seems to find his way on TV. The Scuttlebutt veterans all took a trip to the Battleship Cove in Fall River, Massachusetts. As my mother likes to point out, notice how the gun is not pointed at him. A proud son of Reading, Bill received the stained glass seal of Reading for his 75th birthday, which proudly hangs in his living room at home. Here's some fun quick facts on Bill from back in 2001, when it was his 34th year of town meeting. Not much has changed, just the date in the calendar. Though Bill has never really held a political office within the town of Reading, he served as commissioner on the Reading Municipal Light Department for a year. And all that facts he brings to town meeting just might come from his 100-plus years of town reports. And I kid you not, those are about 100-plus years of town reports. So thank you for your 50 years of hard work and dedication to the town of Reading as a town meeting member. Here's to 51 years and counting. After all, there's still people he has not yet agitated or harassed.
Thank you, everybody. Just one little thing I'd like to correct. In your handout, Bob, in his management thing, said that I don't often change. Well, he doesn't often change either. So we have a lot of good fun. And I think in the whole 50 years, there's only three people that I've been disgruntled with. Two of them were former selectmen. One called me a liar. I mean, traitor, and the other one lied to my face, and the other one, I think you all know, is a building up at Wood End School with his initial on it. But overall, I can say, honestly, I've enjoyed town meeting. If the good Lord willing and my health keeps it, I will run for re-election next year.
All right, now we have to remember where we were. First thing before we start, there's one quick announcement. As I stated last week, we announce instructional motions at the beginning of each session. We got one tonight to instruct the Board of Selectmen, in light of the town's difficult financial situation, to study the Reading Municipal Light Department with an objective of increasing annual revenues to the town of Reading, including the possibility of a sale in the longer term. And now, we left off with the motion under Article 19 on the table. Mr. Arena moves that we take it from the table. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, the motion carries. The business of Article 19 is before the board. Are you going to speak on it? Okay.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for your patience. There was a number of questions that came up about the language last meeting, and I think we've corrected those. And I'm not going to go over the whole presentation, really focusing on a couple of questions that came up and the changes that we made since we last met. And maybe the best thing to do is just walk through these. Hopefully, these changes will be clear. In this first table, the modification here is to delete the word "existing." That's just to make it clear that it's sort of an extraneous word in here. It doesn't matter whether it's existing or new in industrial districts, okay? This table is just about industrial districts. Where we had an issue before was in this table, the changes to section 5.3.2. Essentially, the issue, as was kindly pointed out, was the changes that we had. We ended up with two different lines that said the same thing but controlled the changes differently. So, the motion is to delete the entire line that says detached accessory apartment associated with an existing single-family dwelling. That was the intent, to replace that with the bottom line here, the bottom row here, which regulates that same attached accessory apartment, but has it go through the ZBA for a special permit, both in all of the residential districts and the A40 district as well. The S districts and the A40 district. One more change that came up through that whole discussion was this restriction language was then not consistent with the change in the table. So we had to, the cleanest way to do that is to strike all the references to the districts in this language, so it's just referring back to the table itself. So those are the changes. Hopefully that makes sense. A couple of other things that did come up, some questions that came up. One was, I don't know if it's on here. Yes. We're adding this language here, which basically says that the idea here is that if there's a building, if there's a detached building that someone bought, someone built on their property as of this year, it's existing right now. We're not going to. We don't look to regulate that. If it's there and someone can convert it to an accessory apartment, great. What they couldn't do if it's in that no-build area is expand it further into the no-build area or expand it at all without going through the process. So we don't want to penalize anyone that happens to have a building that's in that no-build area. The other question that came up was how attached accessory apartments fit within that that no-build area that we have the graphics of. This this proposed change doesn't create any regulations on attached structures, additions on where it can sit on the property. That attached addition has to comply with zoning regardless. So it doesn't really, that no build area is just, this no build area here is just related to detached structures for accessory apartments. This is the graphic that came up in question. What we need to do is try and figure out, is define what this, where this line is, the line of the no build line, and that's determined by the principal residence, not by where an accessory apartment happens to be. It's a little bit confusing. Maybe a lot confusing. And that's what I have.
All set?
Yep.
Okay. The chair accepts the proposed changes as a proposed amendment. We'll need to vote on that before we go back to the motion under Article 19. But first, is there any more discussion on the proposed amendment? Not appearing. All those in favor of the proposed amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed, the motion carries. And now we're back to the main motion as amended. Further discussion? None appearing. This requires a two-thirds vote. We will try a hand count first. All those in favor of the motion as amended, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion carries unanimously. Business under Article 20. Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Town meeting members, the next three articles are all linked in some fashion. I'll give a very quick overview. This is for Articles 20, 21, and 22. On last November, as I'm sure you know, ballot question 4 in the state was approved to legalize marijuana. However, in Reading, it failed by approximately 45% to 55%. Right after that election, after that ballot question result, leadership from the Selectmen, the CPDC, and the ZBA, and Town Council and staff met to discuss a path forward. Again, this is all new to Massachusetts. The landscape, if you will, was very uncertain, to put it mildly. And Town Council was really very helpful in leading us through it and discussing a lot of options with Beacon Hill. CPDC immediately advertised a public hearing to discuss a prohibition and a moratorium, both of which in front of you, on the commercial aspects only of marijuana. This step is in the ballot question 4 and was necessary in order to prevent any applicants to come in November or any time shortly thereafter and then be grandfathered. We had a lot of fear of what could happen based on the poor wording, frankly, of ballot question 4 and what was not explicit. The state was very reluctant to give much advice to council, so we thought that the most conservative path was to do things that would allow our voters to have whatever their say would be. The Board of Selectmen then voted to have question 1 on the local ballot in order to hear their opinion. And to be very clear again, this is not impact retail marijuana use, if you will, and this is certainly not impact medical marijuana use. After the public hearings were concluded, CPDC voted again to put Articles 20 and 21, the prohibition and the moratorium, on the warrant. After a discussion with Town Council, who had had several discussions with the state, the Board of Selectmen voted to add Article 22 to the town meeting warrant, which is a request for a home rule petition, basically to strengthen the vote of the local voters on question one, and if town meeting approves Article 20, to strengthen that as well. Again, it's a very uncertain area. There is some gray area. There is some concern, you know, based on the fact that this is a significant financial industry, that some of the approaches by other towns could be overturned legally. The safest thing to do in Massachusetts is to have a home rule petition, which basically restates what you did. So if those other pieces of legislation get overturned, the ability to overturn a home rule petition is very, very difficult in the state. So to sort of go through the path for tonight, in the next few minutes, Article 20 is a zoning bylaw change that would enact ballot question one that was passed by local voters almost 70-30%. If Article 20 does receive two-thirds of your support, we will table Article 21. There would be no need to vote on a moratorium and proceed to the home rule petition to just strengthen your vote and the local voters' vote. If Article 20 does not receive two-thirds support, then we will ask you to vote on a Article 21 moratorium in order to give all your land use boards some ample time to work out whatever the zonings to allow commercial marijuana use should be, and Article 22 would be tabled. So depending on the result of this first article, we'll have one more article to pick up. Is there any questions at that point before I get into this article? Okay. Yes, Anne.
Bob, I think I heard you say that this shouldn't impact marijuana retail, but I see in the definition of marijuana establishment, it includes marijuana retail.
Yeah, when I said retail, I really meant personal use, not retail sales.
Okay,
it's personal use. So again, Article 20 is a zoning. It's always fun when the town manager presents a zoning article. First would be to define what marijuana establishment means and insert that in the definition section. You can see the language behind me and in your warrants. And then quite simply, to put it into two different sections, for business and industrial districts and for residential districts, as we just discussed in the prior article, and ban it from all such districts. That is the article in its entirety. It's really quite simple.
Bylaw Committee report. Mr. Struble.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. At our March 27th meeting, the Bylaw Committee voted 3-1-0 to recommend this article to town meeting.
Is there further discussion? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? This requires a two-thirds vote. We'll try a hand count first. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And we will take a standing count. Do I have my tellers from the other night? Mr. Brown, Mr. Crook, Mr. Rushworth, and Ms. Russell? All those in favor of the motion under Article 20, please rise. Thirty-two. And all those opposed, please rise.
Eight.
Eight.
Seven.
Nine. The vote being 106 in the affirmative, 32 in the negative, the motion carries. Business, let me just write this down. Business under 21, we have a motion to table. Should be, you're absolutely right. We have a motion to indefinitely postpone the motion to Article 21. Mr. Arena? Okay. The motion to indefinitely postpone the motion under Article 21. Is there a second? Second. Any discussion? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. It is indefinitely postponed. Business under Article 2, Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Town meeting members, this is, again, a real simple, straightforward article. This is requesting the legislature pass and the governor sign a home rule petition. I'll read it. An act ratifying and validating the adoption of a marijuana establishment prohibition in the town of Reading. Section 1, notwithstanding any general or special law to the contrary. So that's the important part, no matter what the state thinks. The vote taken by the town of Reading under Article 20 of its annual town meeting of April 24th, 2017, to amend those two zoning sections to prohibit marijuana establishments other than registered marijuana dispensaries, and is authorized by a vote of the voters under question 1 on the local election, and all actions taken pursuant thereto and in reliance thereon, lawyers like that, are hereby ratified, validated, and confirmed. Again, that's just a way of just making sure there's nothing omitted. And then importantly, this act will take effect on its passage immediately, and Representative Jones today assured me this would move very quickly through the legislature and get to the governor.
Let's see, Bylaw Committee, Mr. Struble.
At our March 27th meeting, the Bylaw Committee voted 4-0-0 to recommend this article to town meeting.
Is there further discussion?
Yes, right here.
Ann Landry, Precinct 5. I think I share the concerns that met of many of you about the ability of youth and underage kids to access marijuana. I was hesitant to vote for an article that would categorically exclude a particular type of business from coming to Reading in a time when we are so desperate for additional revenue, but I'd be actually quite interested to hear if anyone has evidence or has become familiar with public health studies that would indicate whether a ban on commercial establishments would actually have some kind of impact on the ability of youth to access marijuana when it's possible they could access it in neighboring communities. So I was curious to hear if anyone is aware of any of those kinds of studies. Thank you.
Is there further discussion? Yes, Mr. Mullen.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jamie Mullen, Precinct 4, and I'm afraid I don't have any information toward your question, but my question is, we were told last year that the state, I believe it was the Attorney General's office, prohibited us from passing a zoning bylaw change that would ban medical marijuana in every zone. And thus we were forced to have at least one zone that allowed medical marijuana dispensary. And I'm just curious why that same logic does not apply, and before town council answers, just something I was thinking about. We have decided in the previous motion to ban commercial marijuana in Reading, primarily because Reading, the voters of Reading did not vote in favor of it in a statewide vote. And I was just thinking, what if that same approach applied on a federal level? So federal laws only applied in states that passed them. Or if we went the other way, what if we decided that precincts that voted in favor of the marijuana law could have commercial establishments, those precincts that voted against it could not? And it's just something to think about and reflects back on that same question. Just because we ban it doesn't mean Wakefield, Stoneham, and so on will not still sell commercial marijuana. So I'm not sure what we've achieved by banning it only in Reading. That's just a thought, but I would like an answer to the medical marijuana versus commercial.
Mr. Meares?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. So the answer to the question is the both the statute governing medical marijuana and the statute governing recreational marijuana were both passed by statewide ballot. That means they were drafted by the proponents. in this case, not the same people, and for whatever reason, they're not drafted anything alike. So, the medical marijuana statute says that there must be at least 5 such facilities in each county. The Attorney General has interpreted that to mean that no town can ban medical marijuana facilities in their entirety because it would interfere with the legal requirement that at least 5 per county be licensed. So that's what they did there. There is no similar provision. In fact, the state law governing recreational marijuana specifically says that towns may ban retail facilities and, in fact, all kinds of commercial establishments. It specifically says they can do it. The uncertainty arises from the fact that it says you have to do it by a vote of the voters, and we don't yet know exactly what that means. So in Reading, you have the most conservative town council ever on this point. I said, do it on the ballot, do it at town meeting, and go for a special act to ratify it. Can't possibly miss. The Attorney General did rule on North Reading's ban on Monday and approved it, but said we're taking no position on whether the ballot question that they have coming up is necessary, or whether the language of the ballot question is correct. So we don't know what the ballot question, all other statutes that deal with ballot questions specifically say this is what the ballot question is supposed to look like. We didn't have that advantage. So there's some small amount of uncertainty here. The Elections Division of the Secretary of State's office recommended that we go the special act route just to nail it down as well as we possibly can.
Mr. LaLaja.
Thank you, Ms. Moderator. I do want to just very quickly hit on the economic development aspect, as believe me, that's something we've thought about, as well as with medical marijuana. It's absolutely a fact that a marijuana business would be lucrative. Would it be more than another business? Well, there is a small tax associated with it, so there would be incremental revenues. But working with the police department and the fire department, the marginal costs that would be put upon Reading, historically, that are in every state that has allowed this, would well outstrip any revenues. So yes, there would be economic development, there would be some additional revenues at the margin. The costs right now would well outweigh that. There is some discussion of greatly increasing the tax. Should the tax greatly increase and the voters' interests change, town meeting can always come back and address this in the future. But for right now, the will of the voters is one part. The other part is the financial difficulty we're in, where this would be a net negative financially. But again, things change. You can always do something in the future.
Yes.
Bob Connors, Precinct 4. My only question with this is, how would this stand a court challenge? Would this really hold up in court?
Mr. Mayaris?
Well, of course, there have been no court challenges, so I have nothing to go on. Mm-hmm. But we will be in the best possible position because we will have a special act that ratifies it. Now, some people, a lot of people are aware that the Attorney General of the United States has made some noises about cracking down on states that legalize marijuana, and federal law could end up preempting this whole thing, but who's to predict what's going to go there? All I can do is put the town in the best possible position, and the best possible position is to have a special act that ratifies what you've already done.
All right, because I just don't want us to go off on some wild goose chase and then have something that just can't withstand the court challenge. And well, another question is, I'm curious, like some towns and communities are still dry. They don't have liquor stores like, I believe, Mellows. And did they do something similar to this, or is it just a bylaw? What do you know?
So, as you might recall from when was that? This fall special subsequent town meeting. The statute governing alcohol required back in the 60s, I believe, for towns to vote at the ballot whether to permit alcohol sales, and it had to be in three consecutive biennial elections. So that's how towns originally elected to allow alcohol sales. Towns that turn that down have traditionally, when they change their mind, have gone and gotten a special act.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Daddario.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron Daddario, Precinct 6. I'm thinking that, I mean, the fact that somebody can, that personal use of marijuana is okay, and a person can go to another town, buy it, and use it, and at least in the state, be safe. So I'm wondering, does it make sense to, we've already passed, I guess it was Article 20. So Article 22 Home Rule petition makes it extremely difficult for us to change if we want to, at least that's what I heard Bob say. And of course, our town manager also said, or our town council said, that we could change this if we wanted in the future. Well, if there's a possibility that we might change this in the future for whatever reason, why make it, why, maybe it might be an idea not to rule for home petition and not nail it down so hard so that if we did want to change it, it wouldn't take an act of Congress.
Mr. Lasher.
Mr. Daddario, I didn't mean to say that it would be more difficult at all. I said quite the opposite, that if the town, through the town meeting, ever wants to change its mind, it's quite possible. Is it an extra step to have to revoke a home rule petition? Sure. Oh, it isn't? Sorry. I better let the lawyer talk.
Mr. Meares.
Okay, so we haven't locked anything. This special act, if enacted, simply ratifies your vote. It doesn't change the rules. It doesn't establish any statutory rules, so that if in the future you decide that you want to change what you have voted, change your zoning bylaw in some way, with luck, we will by then have some rulings about what the proper procedure is, and you and we can follow that procedure. But this doesn't require us, if you decide to change it in the future, it doesn't require you to go back and get a new state statute. This simply ratifies what you did.
Further discussion? People who have not spoken yet? Yes. Mr. Friedman?
I have actually a point of order question for you. There was a question earlier by a town meeting member about the, are there any studies as to the effect of the availability of legal marijuana on use in youth? It's a tough thing to say. And I, as a Board of Health member, we had a discussion about that. Is it okay to, as a selectman, for me to bring that up wearing my former Board of Health hat?
So bottom line is, do you have an answer?
Yes.
Okay, then. Yeah.
Although, sorry, the new guy. It's not a great answer, but there have been a handful of studies in various states, Alaska being one of them, Colorado, and where marijuana has been available legally, either medical marijuana or commercialized marijuana, and they found an increase, a small increase or a small decrease, depending on the state. It was not very informed. That's what I know.
Thank you. Further discussion? Mr. Mon?
Thank you, Jamie Mon, Precinct 4. Just to follow up to my previous question about medical marijuana versus recreational marijuana. As I understand it, the General Court of Massachusetts has not yet passed the specific regulations and law implementing the voters' vote, that they still are making modifications to what was on the ballot. If in those modifications they include a clause parallel to the one for medical marijuana and require or allow up to 5 or 10 commercial establishments per county, would that then invalidate what we've done and make the zoning bylaw for recreational marijuana parallel to the one, the restrictions on the ones for medical marijuana?
Mr. Meares?
Well, there's a lot of ifs in that question. So there are two things going on at the state level right now. One thing is that the legislature is has appointed a committee. And the committee is attempting to rewrite the statute in a way that preserves its intent but makes it a little easier to implement. I have not heard that one of their ideas is to require that a certain number of these establishments exist in each county. But that doesn't mean it couldn't possibly happen. It could possibly happen. The other thing that's going on is there is needs to be, under the existing statute, it requires the creation of the Cannabis Control Commission, the CCC, which is to be appointed by the state treasurer. I understand that the state treasurer is holding off on doing that because one of the ideas that the legislature is considering is taking that authority away from the treasurer and giving it to somebody else. So there's a lot of moving parts here. It's certainly true. The legislature could adopt something similar to that. The legislature could indeed adopt something that says no town can prohibit marijuana facilities. If that happens, we'll have to revisit what we've done, and it will always be my recommendation to bring zoning bylaws and all bylaws into conformance with state law. I don't know, I can't put a probability on that. It seems unlikely to me, but who knows?
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jonathan Barnes, Precinct 5. I agree with the previous speaker that, or Mr. Daddario, a previous speaker, we have already passed Article 20, so I think the horse is already out of the barn, so to speak. But since we're having this conversation, I think it is healthy and appropriate. This is a very, very complicated subject, and it has been presented to us and to the Commonwealth in a very complicated way through the initiative petition. I myself voted for Article 20, the article to prohibit retail marijuana establishments. However, from a personal point of view, or more appropriately, I guess, from my point of view as a town meeting member, I have very ambivalent feelings about it. The citizens of the Commonwealth and the Commonwealth have passed the law, and in fact, through the referendum, the citizens of the Commonwealth have spoken with respect to the legalization of marijuana. and it is a fact in the Commonwealth. And just from a personal point of view, I'm fairly ambivalent or opposed to vice or morality legislation. And in a town where we have not prohibited cigarettes or we have not prohibited alcohol, I find it somewhat hypocritical to prohibit something that is otherwise lawful in Massachusetts. But having said that, and the reason that I voted for Article 20 was largely because of the vote on April 4th in the town in my precinct, or the precinct which I represent, and I just felt compelled because it was so overwhelmingly determined by my constituents, if you will, and by the town that this should be done. I felt compelled to vote as I did, but I'm not entirely in favor of that position for the reasons I've mentioned. Plus, my general feeling is with respect to these types of initiative petitions, I think it's a very poor way to enact legislation. That's why we have legislators, that's why we have the general court, and I think that the manner in which the public educates itself or debates the pros and cons with respect to an issue is virtually absent, if not incredibly small. And in this particular regard, I couldn't help but notice there was, I was unaware of any real debate or discussion that took place regarding the pros of and cons of whether to vote this way. And my own personal feeling is that people perhaps vote that way because it's more or less a feel-good position, because we think it's the right thing to do for some of the reasons that were previously mentioned. But in reality, my personal point of view is I don't think that that vote or the prohibition will necessarily, and it certainly didn't before the vote, protect our children from accessing marijuana or other controlled substance for that matter. So I don't personally think it will serve that purpose. I don't think it'll serve the purpose of removing the black market or illegal or illicit drugs either. So for all of those reasons, I just think it's a bad way to legislate. But as I said, I voted for it for the reason I did, but we're having this discussion and I think it's appropriate. I also thought that from the standpoint of a revenue source where there is, as we've referenced, the ability to have some source of revenue from recreational marijuana establishments, it perhaps would be a source of income. I think my personal point of view is that the town should have supported the Community Preservation Act, which would have also provided revenue, and other acts which would have provided revenue. We turned down the additional tax for restaurants, which would have provided revenue. So for all of those reasons, that's my comment about that. I do have a question, because it is complicated with respect to the implementation, I guess, for town council. As you pointed out, there is, through the initiative petition, there is a law which perhaps the legislature is looking at tweaking, but there is a law that is on the books, and that is that initiative petition. There is a section of that, and I don't know whether you have it before you. I'm aware in Article 20 that what we passed specifically says that a registered marijuana dispensary is not a marijuana establishment. So for purposes of the definition of a marijuana establishment, a medical dispensary is not a dispensary is not a marijuana establishment. Having said that, in section 3 of the initiative petition, the law, the legislation, which talks about local control, which is the section that also contains the provision about the vote, the town vote to prohibit it. But the section before that was very unclear to me with respect to this issue. It says that a city or town can adopt ordinances that impose reasonable safeguards, one of which is the ordinance to prohibit a particular type of a marijuana establishment or all of the types of marijuana establishments. But Section 1 says specifically, provided that these reasonable safeguards can be imposed, provided they're not in conflict with this chapter, and that, number one, they govern time, place, and manner of marijuana establishment operations, et cetera, et cetera. And here's what my question has to do with. It then says, the law, except that zoning ordinances or bylaws shall not prohibit placing marijuana establishment which cultivates, manufactures, or sells marijuana or marijuana products in any area in which a medical marijuana treatment center, a dispensary, is registered to engage in the same type of activity. So as I read that, I was puzzled by that because it seems to say no zoning ordinance or bylaw can prohibit placing a marijuana establishment which cultivates, manufactures, or sells marijuana or marijuana products in any area, in our case the industrial area, in which a medical marijuana treatment center.
Mr. Barnes, you're just about out of time. Could you?
I can wrap it up.
Okay.
So I know that we don't have a marijuana dispensary, but we do have a zone which allows for it. So that just seemed to be somewhat in conflict if we're prohibiting it. Can you address that for me, please?
I can try.
Mr. Mayor.
Thank you.
Okay, so one of the great, the statute that was adopted by the voters under question four last fall creates many mysteries. One of the mysteries is how is that provision that you're citing supposed to be interpreted? First of all, it refers to the area, not the zoning district, but the area in which a medical marijuana facility is located. That's not a defined term. We don't know what constitutes the area. Is it within a mile radius? Is it a block radius? We don't know what it means. It doesn't mean the zoning district, because apparently, so we don't know. We are basically relying in Reading on the fact that there are no such facilities in Reading today. The process for siting those facilities begins with getting the selectmen to issue a letter of non-opposition, if you will. That's in fact what it's called, a letter of non-opposition. Thus far, the selectmen have never issued such a letter in Reading. So not only don't we have one today, but as long as until such time as the selectmen issue such a letter, there won't be one. So. Yes, it is certainly true that, again, a bunch of ifs. If they issue such a letter and if it results in a facility being licensed and if we ever figure out what area means, there may turn out to be a prohibition that we will have to then come back and fix the bylaw to address. But at present time, that's just too much speculation to figure out. We couldn't possibly write that.
Okay, thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, in the back, right in the back.
Tom Grant, Precinct 4. Actually, a sort of similar question. In the motion, it says we're going to prohibit marijuana establishments other than registered marijuana dispensaries. I'm sorry if I missed the definition of a registered marijuana dispensary before. I just was curious what a registered marijuana dispensary is, and if so, why it's being allowed.
Mr. Meares.
The definition of registered marijuana dispensary, that registered medical marijuana dispensary already appears in our zoning bylaw. It is a not-for-profit entity registered under 105 CMR 725.100 that acquires, cultivates, possesses, processes, including development of related products such as edible marijuana-infused products, tinctures, erosis, oils, or ointments, transfers, transports, sells, distributes, dispenses, or administers marijuana, products containing marijuana, related supplies, and educational materials to registered qualifying patients or their personal caregivers. Unless otherwise specified, the term refers to the sites of dispensing, cultivation, and preparation of marijuana.
Mr. Grant?
I appreciate that. I think you said registered medical marijuana dispensaries, right?
That's correct.
In this motion, it says registered marijuana dispensaries.
Yes, that's the term that the public health regulations have.
So they're the same thing?
Yes.
Okay. And then just a different question, not for you, though, thank you, was if ARCASA has discussed this at all. I'm just curious what their, if they have an opinion, I'd love to hear it. Thank you.
Do we have an ARCASA answer? Yes.
Good evening. Yeah, ARCASA is against having any marijuana in town, period.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, right in the middle. Mr. Greenfield.
David Greenfield, Precinct 5. I'm gonna vote against this. I voted against 20. And I think it's a little bit of not in my backyard. But the reality is sales go in our backyard all the time. But they go on behind the scenes. What this does is it pushes sales to the illegal side. And money goes to organized crime. I don't think that's a good thing.
Further discussion? People haven't spoken yet. Mr. Brown?
Peter Brown, Precinct 8. Clearly, as the town voted, and they voted against having a marijuana facility that is a retail to sell or to grow. That was the vote of the town. I respect that, although I disagree with it. I think that Mr. Mears is right. This is, if you support that position, you should vote for the home rule petition. That is the most secure way to prevent any businesses selling pot in Reading. But I want to echo the point of the last speaker, because I reflect a little bit on my own life. I grew up in Linfield, not far away, and when I was in high school, pot was readily available, and I partook in using it. It's the same today in Reading High School. I have had two sons just finished with Reading High School, and I can tell you that I know from discussions with them that it's readily available. So the debate has happened, so it's kind of a moot point, but this really is a not in my backyard position that Reading is taking, and I think that we should be thinking about that in relation to the other communities next to us and our place in society. If you want to buy pot, you can find it, but you're buying it in what up until recently will be an illegal way. You are supporting some form of an underground economy. There's no taxes. There's no revenue from that. Often the associated with, it can be associated with gang activity, or it can be associated with of violence, if in terms of smuggling. So we are really saying as a community, by taking the kind of NIMBY position, that, you know, we're above it. It's, as you know, as Mr. Barnes said, we sell cigarettes, we sell alcohol, but pot, no, that's not okay for Reading, you know. And I think it's now legal in Massachusetts to use marijuana personally. It's clearly, there's advantages on the medical side, which is why it's legal now in some, at least 26 states in the United States. So I think that Reading's position really is one that unfortunately supports underground economy for this for this product, and it really isn't in our best interest. The intent of the regulations are to bring it above ground, and to keep it highly regulated. I think that, unfortunately, was a missed opportunity for us. Thank you.
Mr. Struble?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jeff Struble, Precinct 7. This is a point of information, I think, for you, Mr. Moderator. Seems to me the discussion that's been going on the last couple of minutes really should have occurred under Article 20 and not Article 22, because Article 20 has already passed. If there's a sufficient concern about what's being done here that should have been discussed under Article 20, could Article 20 be reconsidered by a motion to reconsider by someone from the prevailing side?
Yes, you could.
Could you explain that? There's a lot of new people.
If we want to reconsider Article 20, it needs to be done by somebody who is on the prevailing side or winning side,
right,
and it would become the first order of business at our next session.
Understood. Okay, so it's really not the horse is gone, but you can get the horse back.
Further discussion. Mr. Crook.
Stephen Crook, Precinct 2. Move the question.
Is there a second? Second. Okay, this requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor of ending debate, please rise. Twenty-six. Those opposed to ending debate, please rise.
Ending debate?
Those opposed to ending debate, yes.
12.
Thirteen.
21.
16. Vote being 82 in the affirmative, 62 in the negative, the motion does not carry. Debate continues. Further discussion. Yes, on the aisle.
Jeffrey Corum, Precinct 7. My understanding of what Town Council explained to us is that, we've had two votes, the townwide election on the 4th and the vote that we just had on Article 20, and his explanation was that we needed essentially that there are three ways that one could possibly interpret the state ballot question that was out there as to what the will of the voters was, and that having done these other two votes that we had against marijuana establishments, that this last question is simply finalizing the debate so that no aggressive establishment could perhaps sue the town and say, hey, you didn't actually vote in this way, have the voters vote against something, and therefore take us to court and force us to defend our position or force us to go through this home rule petition at some point in the future. So I would think that having had these two other votes against the marijuana petition, we just need to finish off dotting our I's and crossing our T's and put this behind us. Thank you.
Further discussion. Miss woman in front of you.
Ann Landry, Precinct 5. Thank you to Selectman Friedman for answering my question about studies. And Bob, thank you for addressing the economic development question that you put my mind at some ease. I did have a follow-up question about the studies that were comparing other states that have legalized marijuana and making sure we're comparing apples to apples. Those other states that had increased costs for the public safety departments, was that looking at a situation where there was a statewide legalization leading to some increased revenue, but overall public safety cost increases Or was it a situation similar to what we're trying to pursue here, where we would become a bit of an island in a sea where marijuana establishments are legal? So my concern is, are we going to incur public safety costs from surrounding communities where marijuana establishments are legal without reaping any of the revenue benefits?
Mr. LaLasha.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I think the getting right to the point in Reading specifically, and Chief certainly correct me, the biggest concern was marijuana is a cash business. The police are needing to both protect the residents, the customers, and the owners of the business, and the amount of staffing needed for that protection for as many hours as an establishment be open is significant. I know the chief has looked at a state such as Colorado, but I don't know that we want to infer too much data from another state into Reading so much as just the actual way that the bylaw or the, sorry, that the legislation has been enacted. My understanding is there is one local bank, and I don't mean Reading, I mean Massachusetts, that is considering going into the marijuana business for credit card. Otherwise, it's cash. That's a very poorly thought out legislation to force any business to be only cash. That's asking for trouble. So it's really not so much a data-driven decision as the way it was instituted, the way it currently sits on the books. And I know it's the opinion of law enforcement in this state completely, is that it's going to be a very expensive area for any given city or town. I know that many of our neighbors are doing the same thing we are, but even if they weren't, our responsibility is for businesses in Reading specifically. If people bring marijuana into the town, that's not the same concern as protecting the business and the customers in our borders.
Further discussion. Mr. Crook.
Stephen Crook, Precinct 2. A point of order. A lot of the discussion on Article 22 seems to center around health issues, economic issues, and actually my colleague on the bylaw committee brought up that question a moment ago. Should not the debate on this be limited to the merits of having the legislature ratify and validate our vote on Article 20, and not at this point the merits of Article 20 itself, or the merits of a ban itself, or the merits of a moratorium, should have Article 20 had not passed?
That is a point well taken. We have the 20 is really where the vote, the discussion probably should have taken. We will confine discussion as to whether or not we should send this to the state to ratify what we have voted. That's a good point. Further discussion? Yes, on the far corner? Yes. Actually, okay. We reversed that, but I will call on you next.
Bruce McKenzie, Precinct 8, thank you. I'd like to amend the motion to add the word medical so that it reads registered medical marijuana dispensary. The reason is just to be consistent with the previous motion.
Where are you adding the word?
Change the phrase registered marijuana dispensary, adding the word medical so that it reads registered medical marijuana dispensary.
Okay, we have a second. I just want to make sure we got that. Is there a second? Second, okay.
Could you ask if that could be a friendly amendment?
Well, it's an amendment. It's either we're going to vote on the amendment, we're going to discuss that amendment. Do you have a comment on that?
The town has no objection to that amendment.
Okay.
I don't know.
Is there further discussion on that proposed amendment? None appearing. All those in favor of the proposed amendment, please raise your hand. Those opposed, motion carries. Okay, further discussion on motion is amended. None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? This only requires a majority vote, but when we send something to the general court, we generally have a standing count. So I will ask all those in favor, please rise.
Twenty-nine.
Thirty-three.
All
those opposed, please rise.
Seven.
Nine.
Eight.
Eight. Nine. The vote being 113 in the affirmative, 33 in the negative, the motion carries. Business under Article 23. Mr. LaLasha. Do we have a presentation? Oh, okay.
I'm retiring from zoning.
Hello again. So on Monday, February 13th, 2017, CPDC convened to hold a public hearing on the proposed Article 23. All documents were made available on the town website. The public hearing was held to provide an opportunity for comment and determine whether the provisions of the proposed zoning bylaw amendment shall be adopted by the town. On February 13th, public hearing was opened at approximately 8:30 p.m. Any comments received at the hearing were included as part of the record of the hearing. The hearing was closed. The CPDC voted 4-0-0 to recommend Article 23 to town meeting. So the good news is the wording on this one is much easier than the last one. We have two articles here that are connected. Article 23 is focused on changing the regulations related to the downtown smart growth district. It's an overlay district in downtown on the number of affordable units that are required for any development that uses that set of regulations. To date, we have one development that has used that set of regulations. That's the Haven Street property, the old Atlantic supermarket. Development is the only one that's used that, but that's the type of development that would use these downtown smart growth regulations. So we wanted to make two changes, and these two changes actually just bring these affordable regulations. They match up with the state regulations. And the first one is to change the requirement for properties that are developed as rental properties from a 20% affordable unit mix up to 25%. What that would do if a development were built using these using this set of regulations is that we would be able to use the entire development to count as affordable in our affordable inventory. So, you know, if there's, well, you guys can do the math, that's easy enough. Right now it's set at 20, and so only those units that are designated as affordable count in our inventory. If we set it at 25, then the entire development gets counted. The other change that we would like to make is creating an exemption for smaller developments. The state allows developments up to 12 units to be exempt from any affordability requirements. And the feedback that we've gotten is that there may be some other developments that happen in this district using these sets of regulations, and it might be two or three or four units, you know, second and third floor. And if you keep to that 20%, it starts to get very cumbersome and convoluted and too expensive to bring in that whole affordability component for one unit. And so that's the reasoning behind making these, wanting to make these changes, is to make this zoning overlay district work a little bit better for the town and work better for developers in terms of spurring development.
Further discussion? Yes, right in the middle.
Good evening, Mary Ann Downing, Precinct 3. Just a question about the exemption. Could a developer play games with the way they're setting something up? So say they had 30 units and they're gonna break it up and we're gonna call this, you know, some name just so to make it look like, oh, I'm responsible for all of these, but I'm calling them three separate projects to get around the requirement.
I'm not gonna say that a developer couldn't play games with us and try and do something, because that's always a worry of ours. In downtown Reading, remember, thinking about where we're talking about and the size of the amount of property that we're talking about isn't very big. So the ability for some developer to come in and have that much flexibility to try and break up a development into different phases I can't imagine how one would do that. Could someone do that and phase it in different pieces? Perhaps.
I mean, the parcels in the zone aren't that big, so it seems like that would be very easy to do.
So in in the regulations, it is specifically called out that a developer isn't able to try and phase projects so that they can get around affordability. We do have that listed as part of the sets of regulations. So they're sort of it's already in there.
So I misunderstood. You said they are allowed to phase projects?
No, they are not.
They are not?
No,
okay.
No, they are not allowed to phase projects to try and get around affordability requirements.
Okay, thank you. Otherwise, I encourage my fellow town meeting members to vote at least for the first part, because then we could have had at 30 Haven all 50-something units be affordable had that provision been in place back when it was built. Thank you.
Further discussion. Mr. Mon.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jamie Maughan, Precinct 4, and I have two questions. The first one is, if this does not pass, but a developer proposes 30% affordable, could we still count the entire development toward our affordable inventory.
Mr. Meares.
I'll first say that's very unlikely, first off, but I don't know about the actual requirements. I mean,
so if it's not required, then it would suggest that the developer would have to get this approved as a so-called LIP agreement or go through the 40B process. But it is true that any development that has 25% of any development that has rental units has 25% of them meet the qualifications to be affordable. However we got there, the 100% would count towards the subsidized housing inventory.
Okay, thank you. And the second question is just out of curiosity. Can our assistant town manager, our planner, tell us what the limit or what the rent is for, let's just say, for example, a one-bedroom to make it affordable? In other words, what rent qualifies as affordable for, say, a one-bedroom or a two-bedroom house in Reading?
Ms. Mercer.
Okay. Thank you, Jamie. So the affordability limits are set by HUD every year. And they have calculations that people who are proposing rental housing have to go through to figure out what the maximum rent can be. A household is not supposed to spend more than 30% of their monthly income on rent, or they're considered cost burdened. So basically you work backwards from the maximum, an income eligible person's maximum income divided by 12, divided by 30%, and then that's the maximum they could spend each month. And then that's also supposed to include things like utilities, condo fees, tax. So that's kind of how they figure out the monthly. I can't tell you, like right now, what that number is, but if I went back to my office and found the calculations, I could tell you.
Further discussion? Yes.
Matt McLeod, Precinct 2. So basically the goal here is to mandate everybody to move to 25% so that from our state at 8.49 right now, we can get to 10% by actually not even getting to 9%. That's our goal.
Yes, the goal is to increase affordable housing in town. Yes.
No, it's to increase the score for affordable housing in town, not the amount.
Yes. Well, remembering from my perspective is that this affordable housing score is really the game. We have a lot of affordable housing in town. Affordable housing is only counts for the state when it is deed restricted. Only when it's deed restricted. So these our previous discussion about accessory apartments that for everyone here might be affordable.
Yes.
Those don't count unless someone puts a deed restriction on them.
Mr. O'Sullivan? Oh, I'm sorry, I mistook you. Yes.
Hi, Nicholas Worth, Precinct 7. I just was wanting to ask if the committee could explain to us the state Reading's in reference to the regulations on affordable housing. Yeah. Are we in good stand? What do we make the level of affordable housing?
We're at 8.49%, okay. And we're trying to get to 10%.
Okay. And is there any capacity to grandfather in? I don't know if any complexes do make the 25% limit already, but is there any capacity to grandfather in any places that do have that?
The answer is no. This is specifically to change an overlay district for projects that are going to be built using this overlay district.
All right, thank you very much.
Really apply to existing developments.
All right, thank you very much.
Further discussion? Mr. Daddario.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron Daddario, Precinct 6. Just two questions. One, it says, of course, that's only for rental property. Is there any such thing for ownership? Is that a possibility?
For ownership.
For the 25%.
Ownership, the threshold is, it's 20%, right? Yeah. Ownership, the threshold is 20%. You don't get the whole building. You only get the actual units. That's the threshold that's set by the state. That's the threshold that we already have in the regulations.
Okay. The other thing is the 12 units on number two. Mm-hmm. Is there a 10% on that, or is it zero? Is it no? No.
It's zero.
Zero.
0%. Yes.
All right. And you said that it might not be financially possible for the developer to do it, to put it. But is it, what about if we could we cut it to 10 units instead of 12? And could it be like 10%? You know what I mean? Could we get one unit out of 10? At is that possible?
12 is a limit. The limit is 12. Could we have moved it down to 10 units?
Well, two things.
As an exemption.
Yeah. I mean, do we have the power to move it down to 10?
Excuse me?
Do we have that power to move it down to 10?
We could, yeah.
Oh well. And
I mean, before we didn't have an exemption, so we could move it down to zero. But the idea here was to provide to take off some of the affordability requirements for smaller developments to try and spur investment in downtown. So 12 was the number established by the state. That's the number that we used.
So if we got 12 units, that puts us further behind, because we need the 10%. That puts us behind.
Correct.
Is 12 a magic number? I mean, is that something, or that came from the state? That's how that number
That came appeared. From the state, yeah. We can't go any higher. We could go lower in terms of the exemption.
Well, could I make an amendment and just put 10? And could I make that amendment?
Is that your intention?
And just change the 12 to 10 units?
Are you making that motion?
I would like to.
Okay.
And just go with 10 and anything 10
below. Is there a second?
Anything above that, we would at least get a unit.
Okay, all discussion right now is on changing the number of units from 12 to 10. Is there further discussion on that proposed amendment? Mr. Sasso.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. John Sasso, Precinct 2. Specifically related to this, but also this whole discussion we're having, I mean, this isn't just about...
We are discussing that proposed amendment.
I am. I think this is important and relevant, too, because this relates to the numbers. So I think the purpose of doing this, making it 12 or whatever the number may be, is to generate, as you just said, interest in the downtown and improving it. We also get financial benefit by them using the downtown smart growth 40R district. So it's more than just affordability. There's I don't know what the law is in terms of the money that goes into the... Maybe you know the details that you can share with the rest of town meeting. So part of the rationale of having that as 12, I think, is to then say, well, we're really trying to generate, more interest in getting development projects there, not just for affordability, but also to enhance the downtown, but also to we do get benefit financially for every unit that's built. There's what the number is off the top of your heads, but. So I guess bottom line, I'd suggest, given the fact that we really haven't had any other activity going on down there relative to this particular smart growth relative to this particular smart growth district. I suspect that's part of the rationale for bringing it up to 12 is to also generate that. So I'm for keeping it at 12, but maybe you can answer that question for the rest of town meeting. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Ms. Snyder?
Gina Snyder, Precinct 5. I agree with Ron. I mean, if we have a high minimum there, we're just, every time one of these smaller developments go in, we're going to fall further and further behind. And I'm trying to remember what's proposed at the post office. There's not a whole lot of detail, but I think, you know, it would be nice to see some affordable units go in there, and I don't know that it's a whole lot more than 12. So we are seeing people come in under what we already have. So I disagree with the last speaker, and I agree with Mr. Daddario that we should lower it to 10. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Yes.
If I can answer the previous question.
So with regard to the density, what we get from the state, we would get a density bonus equal to $3,000 per unit. We also get are supposed to get some money for passing the zoning bylaw itself. Specifically the one thing to keep in mind with 12 versus 10, it comes down to math. So at 25% for 12, it ends up with a fraction of a unit, which then gets rounded up anyhow. So in order to eliminate units, you would need to bring it down more, so that we don't have fractions of units as requirements, because then it'll just get bumped back up anyways.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. Yes.
Jean Delios, I just wanted to add a couple of things to the discussion about this exemption for the small projects. We had a number of public forums last summer, and one of the things that we heard loud and clear from the people that were at the forum, and a lot of them were property owners in the downtown, we did a mailing to everyone within 1,000 feet, is we heard that for the smaller projects, this would be a tremendous benefit to spur activity. So I'd like to say that, you know, we came up with this idea on our own, but we really heard it when we went out into the community and started asking questions about how do we shape this and how do we craft this so that we can reach our goal in town of what I think is pretty widely accepted, that the downtown has some tremendous potential, and it's in our economic development plan and a lot of the other plans that we've done. But when we have these meetings and try and get feedback, that was one of the biggest things that we heard, is that for projects of a smaller scale, this would be a tremendous benefit to get those projects going. Thank you.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment. There's a gentleman in the middle. Yes. I have 2 points of order. Hold on a second. Do we have the right number 12 changed?
This is okay.
Should they both be changed?
No. To actually change the motion, not the presentation.
Where is the second place? You got it? Okay. And we had another point of order over here, Ms. Russell.
Maybe you're catching it. We're not voting on what was up on the screen. We're voting on what was in here. Correct?
Correct, yes.
That was not the motion. That was the rationale for the motion that we were looking at on the screen. I believe what we're voting for is the motion that's printed
correct
in our warrant.
Isn't that what we're looking at there? Oh, I'm sorry. By the time I looked, it was up there. So I understand what your question is now. Okay. Yes, I'm sorry. Continue. Yes.
Todd Merkel, Precinct 8. You know, I think we should, before we vote on reducing the 12-unit threshold somewhat arbitrarily to 10 units, I think we should hear the benefit of understanding where the 12 number was arrived at in the first place, especially if there was a significant investment of time, invested in understanding what's going to attract the smaller developments from the development community. I don't think we've heard sort of where the 12 came from to start with, and I don't think we should just reduce it for the sake of reducing it to an arbitrary number.
Ms. Mercer?
Thank you. I can attempt to answer that question. So when we had the public forums for downtown zoning and for specifically this amendment, we heard from some people in the development community that the number should actually be larger than 12. 12 is the maximum project that the Chapter 40R will let us exempt from affordability requirements. So we didn't consider actually going lower because we were hearing from everyone that it should be higher.
Further discussion? Yes. In the middle? Yes.
Eileen Manning, Precinct 5. My understanding of how this rule would work is that the ZBA has the ability, it uses that as a boundary. Nothing would preclude it if a 40R applicant were to come and say, no, you know, we'll only allow you to do this up to 10 units. That really, it gives the ZBA a boundary, but within 40R, they have flexibility for a specific development to make the ruling different. Is that correct?
Ms. Mercer.
First of all, just to clarify, these projects would be before the CPDC, not the ZBA. But are you asking if a project came in that was 10 units, how it would be reviewed, or are you?
I'm asking more that does this give the CPDC that boundary and they have flexibility on a particular project to say, no, we will only allow you to build 8 without affordability, without an affordable unit?
I'm not sure. That doesn't seem, I'm not exactly sure I'm understanding the question.
Can that board make it stricter than the boundary you're giving it here?
No.
Is that, Brady, you want to?
Yeah. Right. Mr. I just thought I could just feed her the answer and go sit down. So this is the way zoning works. If you comply with all the provisions of the zoning, you get your permit. So if the requirement says that for a project that's 12 units or less, you don't need to have an affordable unit, then you're entitled to build it without an affordable unit. The CPDC doesn't have the discretion to say, yeah, but you have to have an affordable unit.
Okay, thank you.
Further discussion, yes.
Mr. Moderator, Nick Safina, CPDC. The benefit of this exemption is that someone would potentially take advantage of the downtown Smart Growth District, which gives us design standards and much better resulting projects. And so, as Gene mentioned, developers were reluctant to hear this number. They wanted 16, 18, 20. If we could convince people to come up to the 12 and build something of quality that's defined in this Smart Growth District, that's worth something to us, even if we're not getting the affordable unit on this one smaller one. Because when those 50 and 60 and 70 unit apartment buildings come in, that's where we need to capture it.
Further discussion on the proposed amendment? None appearing. All those in favor of the amendment to reduce the number of units from 12 to 10, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion does not carry. We now return back to the main motion. Further discussion? Yes, Ms. Snyder.
T
Gina Snyder, Precinct 5. I just wanted to ask a couple clarifying questions. The development that came in as Archstone, that was 25% affordable, right? So we get credit for 100% of that.
Ms. Delios?
Archstone was a 40B.
Right.
So that is, this we're talking about 40R.
I know, but I'm just saying, they came in as 25%, right? We're getting credit
they have
for 100%.
To under 40B, yeah.
That's 25% they... under 40B? Oh, I thought it was 20.
Yeah.
Does the deed restriction expire at some point?
Are you talking about for 40R?
Well, either one. Does
the state has a huge amount of input into deed restrictions, every kind of legal document you can imagine, affirmative marketing plans. The paperwork that goes to the state is about the size of, for those of us who are old enough, the old yellow pages. There's huge amounts of detail and oversight from the state on every aspect of the affordability component. So that's the state has made that into a very big process. There has to be a monitoring agent. It's very involved. So,
well, I remember hearing that Cedar Glen's deed restriction was expiring, so I was just wondering, is it correct that these deed restrictions...
With the deed restrictions from older projects, things that happened 30 years ago or 20 years ago, it's completely different now. It's a lot more regulated, heavily regulated by the state. We're dealing with a lot of old deeds and old regulatory agreements, and it's very murky, the old stuff, but not now.
Okay, so you're making a distinction in this one between rental and ownership.
Yes.
So my last question is, if an Oak Tree-like development came in, as they did, promoting condos that they were going to sell, and then they said, oh, we can't do that, the market's different, we're going to rent, what would happen?
Well, the CPDC can only respond to what's before them. If they come in as they did and said, we're going to put apartments in, that's what the CPDC is holding the public hearing on. And that's what the approval and the decision will be based on, all of the material that gets submitted, including what type of unit that it would be.
Yeah, but now it would be zoned that if it was for sale, it's 20%, but if you turn it into rental, it's 25%. How would the zoning impact that decision on the part of the developer?
What the CPDC approves is what has to get built. We follow up in excruciating detail. If they were going to change it, they would have to come back to the CPDC and basically refile if it's something that drastic.
Okay, thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, in the back again.
Todd Merkel, Precinct 8. With respect to the first part, again, in terms of increasing the threshold from 20 to 25 for rental units or rental projects, I understand the objective in terms of being able to count the entire projects unit count towards the total instead of just the 20%. My question is from a different angle, which is, where does that put us relative to the market, meaning our surrounding communities, as developers look to develop apartment communities? Where are surrounding communities in terms of that threshold versus us? Because obviously, if we go to 20 to 25, the economics to the developer diminish, which may be fine. I just don't want to put us in a position where we're off market.
I'll start with this. The good thing is that these are the thresholds that are set by the state. So, for this type of zoning overlay district. So there are a lot of communities that use that as the starting point. So I don't know. I mean, there are some others in, there are developments, apartment developments that are happening all around us, right? I don't know what the affordability percentage is that other towns have, but I can tell you that that everyone's, at least in the immediate area, is in the same ballpark that we are trying to encourage development get affordable units up.
Right,
and this is sort of a good place to start it for every community, because it's that threshold that the state.
I guess my question is, if let's say, for example, a developer is looking at some other community that has our current threshold of 20% as the affordable requirement for a rental project, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And the pro forma for that deal produces a certain economic return to the developer, and then they look at Reading, and they have to build 25% of their total unit count as affordable. That's my question, right? We're not in the same boat if we change to a situation where when a developer looks to build in our community, the economics to that developer are worse than in a surrounding community.
Gene's going to have some more input, but one thing I would hope, this is a hope, and something that I truly believe, is that downtown Reading is unique. What we've heard from developers, right, I think our economic development professional here would back me up, is that there's more to Reading than just a particular site to build a unit. So you know, there are some communities, and Reading's one of them, that we have something, we might be able to, it's not just the bottom line. There's more value in being in a downtown like Reading, near the train, near the downtown.
No, I understand all that. So, I agree with that.
One speaker at a time, please. Let them finish.
But the numbers part, I
want to know is, does this make us an outlier? I understand all the soft tissue points about Reading being more attractive than other. I get all of that. Just statistically, it would be nice to know whether by voting on this we're making ourselves different than everyone else.
Yeah,
that's all.
Two things. One, there are surrounding communities that have a zoning provision known as inclusionary zoning, and that has a requirement. It varies. Sometimes it's 20%, sometimes it's 15%. But there are surrounding communities that require developments across the community to comply with inclusionary zoning and provide affordable housing. We don't have that. So that would be, I would think, make a community, if you want to say less attractive, it would be an added requirement that we don't have here in Reading. When we looked at downtown smart growth zoning back in 2009, there weren't a lot of other examples of it around, certainly not around here. So what Reading has is they have the downtown smart growth zoning, which provides incentives for doing the kinds of developments like 30 Haven, adjacent to public transportation. And that, I think, those are the things that make it unique. In exchange for that, we're looking for this affordable component. So you get to do some things that you wouldn't normally be able to do in zoning, but then there are the affordability. Okay. So I don't think it hurts us. That's
okay.
My point.
That's my only question.
I think we're in a very strong position, and you can see it from the development that we have seen. And we heard at a lot of the 40B hearings for the 40B down at the train station, the neighbors down there said, we wish we had 40R, because we have some measure of control over it versus a 40B. So I think the 40R is a very helpful tool. And I think it puts us in a strong position.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes.
Cynthia Kuhl, Precinct 6. I'm just wondering, what is the outlook for the number of affordable care units that will be increased, and do you suppose that this will ever go way beyond our expectation of affordable care units? Like, we have just way too many in the town of Reading, because that would be dreadful. I mean, what do you think? I mean, is this just how much growth are you expecting, and how many units do you suppose this may will go way over our quota of like 10% of our, you know, of our
do
total?
Do we have an answer?
This is a change, but not a drastic change from where we have been for the past, how many years? 8 years? So I don't see this spurring so much development downtown that we can't handle it. I just don't think that will happen. I think that two things: this will allow us to count for the state inventory some affordable units that we can't count in our equation today.
I'm gonna vote for this one.
And the hope is what Mr. Safina said is that there are some smaller developments that may be able to be built using this.
But I don't think it's a big situation.
Let's have one speaker at a time. If you ask the question, please let him finish.
Okay.
I don't think this will create overwhelming growth in downtown.
Okay, that was the real critical part of my vote. Anyway, I needed to understand that, and nobody seemed to bring that part of it up. So sure. I will definitely vote for it. I think it's win-win either way, because you're getting all these extra that apartments or whatever that are affordable care, even though they're not. So it's not like bringing in a lot of affordable care units. So that are really affordable care units, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I'm gonna vote for it.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, we're in the aisle.
Demetra Tsekris, Precinct 4. Sorry. A quick question. I understand why you wanted to be aggressive going down to 12 units, where developers were asking for higher, 16, 18, I think you said. Were there any developers, do you have any developers that you think, are you hoping that there are developers out there who will develop to 12, or have you identified some? And is there merit in actually, I hate to say it, raising the number from 12 to maybe 16? Or is that something that you all determined would be too large a growth for this area in town?
To start off, we can't raise it any higher than 12. That's a limit the state's put on us for the exemption.
Okay.
So that's
that
number.
Answers that.
That answers that.
So.
And the other question was, have we talked with any developers that are waiting in the wings? I don't know of any. I can't answer that question, part of the question.
So just to follow up, so developers who wanted 16, 18, they were just being unrealistic. That's what they wanted, but the state won't let that happen.
So if someone comes in and wants to build 18 units,
they
can build 18 units. They just need to comply with with the 20 or 25%, whatever type of development
Understood.
They're happening.
Thank you.
All right.
Further discussion? Not appearing. Are we ready for the vote? This requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor, please rise.
Forty-one.
And those opposed, please rise.
Zero.
I guess we could have taken a hand count. 145 in the affirmative, 0 in the negative. The motion carries. Business under Article 24. Mr. LaLasher.
Sorry. So Article 24 proposes to amend the downtown smart growth district, as we've been talking about, to expand that district from its current limits to meet up with the current downtown business B limits. When we originally considered
the downtown smart growth district, we looked at a number of boundaries for it and eventually settled on where the current limits are. And what we're thinking now is that this will help to capture some of the peripheral spaces around that area that are ripe for some of this development that we think this type of zoning will help spur. So as we mentioned, we've been discussing the downtown smart growth district with in public forums with property owners, with developers, and we all felt that what you see here, well, most of us felt that what you see here is a good boundary. Let's see what that map is. Here it is. So the red bounded property, the red bounded area is the current existing downtown smart growth district, and the area in blue captures the rest of what is currently the Business B district. It captures Main Street down to Washington, where is it? And over towards Lincoln Street.
All set?
Yep.
Okay. Further discussion? Yes, right here. Mr. Herrick.
Steve Herrick, Precinct 8. Could you maybe, I'm going to display my ignorance here, elaborate a little bit more on what is exactly this does. So for a piece of property that currently exists in this proposed district, the zoning doesn't change, but what is the actual impact of to a property? What are we changing? What could we do to that property now that we couldn't do before?
Sure. So this is an overlay district. So all of the underlying zoning and your property rights exist, downtown Business B. This allows you to use the downtown smart growth district zoning as another opportunity. So you don't lose any rights, if you will. You're actually gaining a potential economic benefit by developing it in a different way. We don't allow housing in the Business B. This is a way of doing a mixed-use project like Haven Street with a commercial element and some residential above that. And that's, you know, if you think about that, that's supposed to spur some activity along the streetscape and bring people to the downtown to use those businesses that are down there. And in addition to that, this is a mechanism for us to get some affordable units. We do have design standards which are enforceable, which are, it's not something that a lot of other zoning opportunities have. That means that we have criteria that they have to comply with. That gives us some density and scale and quality architectural elements.
So in that respect, would that restrict any development in that area to this new design standards?
No, you can take advantage of any of the existing or this particular piece of zoning. You can take advantage of any zoning that's available to you.
You said that that currently does not allow housing, but there is, I'm looking at that map, and I believe there is some, maybe not, there, I know there is some housing in that area, so I'm just, what does that mean exactly? Help me out.
Well, this is new housing.
New housing.
Sure.
So you're saying this
those
is
are all grandfathered
those are all
in.
Grandfathered.
Yeah. No one's going to come down and, no one's going to take those houses down.
Further discussion. Ms. Young?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Megan Young, Precinct 4. Nick, I just had a question. I know that the other side of Lincoln Street is not Business B, but I also know from EDSAT, the report, they talked about that area right, well, I know there's currently going to be a development, but that little triangle area was also a good area for us to consider downtown smart growth. Do we see doing that later, eventually, or something like that?
Talking about
on the other, like, yeah. On the other side of, yeah, the railway
oh,
station.
Here?
Yeah, exactly. There in that triangle to the far left. Do you know what I mean? Like, I guess it would be Woburn Street.
This piece.
Is that Woburn? Woburn. Because that, yeah, just that, I think the EDSAT report said that that area on the other side of the train station was also a good area to consider for smart growth. I just didn't know, I understand we're doing it as an overlay for business B. I just didn't know if you were anticipating maybe doing that later.
We stayed within the limits of business B because we felt that all of those areas were compatible with the current regulations and the design standards. And as you start venturing away from those areas like that, that's a very residential section. And even, for example,
We know it's being done right now, right?
Well, the 40B,
right.
We could rezone that if you want, but what's the point? It's already a 40B.
Well, the area right on the other side is an old apartment house, right? And there's a few houses, so it's very similar to what is currently in business B now.
Right. So this whole section, at least in my opinion, the front side of it, say the Lincoln Street side of it, perhaps is easily addressed by the current standards. But the back side of that now fronts on a smaller residential street. And I don't think we have the kind of...
Like Gould Street does, right?
Yeah. So you know, we've been talking about having some sub-district design standards potentially to start addressing these little nuances in that.
Okay.
And I think that that triangle seems to be more complicated than it appears.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Barnes?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jonathan Barnes, Precinct 5. I'm certainly not opposed to the concept, although, as I think I've expressed at other forums, the notion of the need for revenue and the need for economic development is certainly significant. There seems to be some issue in town with respect to retaining a lot of the businesses that we already have. I can't help but notice as I wander around the downtown area, there's a lot of empty storefronts there, and I am just concerned about venturing ahead with expanding the opportunity for that, and running into a wall of having additional empty retail, commercial or retail space. But having said that, it's a laudable goal, and I agree. Although this particular section is certainly different than, as you mentioned, the existing downtown smart growth district, because it does contain, I believe, more of a residential neighborhood in that Gould Green Ash Street area. I guess I'm just curious. So obviously, if there is some success in attracting some developers, that's going to deconstruct that residential neighborhood. I'm just curious, do we know how many residential units are in that area? And do we know, in fact, of those residential units, how many the residents that live in that neighborhood?
I don't have that number.
No?
But they're individually owned, so, you know, it's not like someone's going to come in and there's not going to be a taking of all these properties for some particular developer.
That may or may not be the case. I don't know who owns them or whether the folks who own those units rent them. And I guess I'm just expressing, if we're going forward with expanding the downtown smart growth district in an area where there is at least the potential to displace a residential community, if I don't know whether those homes are owned by people from outside of Reading who might be very eager to sell them to a developer and displace folks who are renting, and I don't know whether people think that's good or bad, but I would like us to at least consider some opportunity as we go forward with this to at least give consideration to the displacement of the residential community in that area. Thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Bill Brown, Precinct 8. One of my favorite expressions is the only thing that changes is the date in the calendar. Back growing up in Reading in the 40s, we had a lot of apartments above the store, and then all of a sudden we came along and zoned them out. Now we're trying to put it back in. So nothing changes except the date in the calendar.
Further discussion? Yes, in the far corner. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Dave Talbot, Precinct 5. I have a couple questions. One is, have the property owners within the new district been notified of the proposed zoning change?
Yes, that is a requirement of any map amendment.
And how about the ones in the abutting properties, the residential abutters?
We notified abutters within 1,000 feet of this area at least once in the lead up to this zoning amendment.
The changes are, I mean, the concept is wonderful, and we want the residential above the, we want the mixed use, it's great. The concern that I've heard in numerous quarters is that how, for the success of the Haven Street project, is that it's massively dense, and especially the rear of it is just one wall of, a sheer wall of a four-story building. It's quite jarring. One of the major changes that is not really discussed is that there was, as part of this, is that developers can go from 85% lot coverage, which it always has been downtown, to 100% lot coverage. And the 100% lot coverage is a serious impediment to any kind of open space, any green space, any pocket park, any alleyway between buildings. You'll notice walking down Haven Street, it's a football field or more of length. You can't walk between that and the other new building. There's no greenery around it. The little pocket park that was created on Haven Street was created by giving away some parking spaces and actually, you know, making that little concrete U-shaped, because the site itself, whereas under the previous zoning would have had to have had 15% open space, now was allowed to have 100% of the building. And they were given, they kept being given more and more units to where there's now 50 or more units. So this is an aspect of this that's gonna have a big impact, is this 100% lot coverage. So I'm just wondering, has that, I know that in conversations with a number of people in the room that this has been a concern, so what happened to that concern about the 100% lot coverage?
Ms. Mercer?
The concern that you mentioned, the 100% lot coverage concern, actually never came up during any of our public hearings for this. As with regards to the 30 Haven project, I think I'll let Nick, do you have anything to say about that?
I mean, 30 Haven built to its limits. I think you have to understand what downtown is from sort of a formal standpoint, right? Those storefronts are on the property line, and buildings tend to be one next to the other. Sometimes there's no space between them. The developer may be able to build to 100% of the lot, but will they, if they need access, if they need some sort of parking, if they want some open space for their people? I mean, I think that, you know, we're assuming that they're gonna build, you know, right to the maximum height and right to the maximum width, when they're gonna be trying to do something that's attractive as well, because they need to sell those units or rent them. And they need access to those units, and they need to meet building code, as well as our design standards. So I don't think that 100% coverage as a guide for the downtown area is problematic. I think it'll work.
Does any other community in the suburbs have 100% lot coverage?
85, right. Well, Business B is 85%, yeah. You mentioned that.
I'm just curious, does any other town have 100, allow 100% lot coverage? With no, not even 5% for a little patch of green and a bench and a tree or a little alleyway between these projects? Or is Reading the only one that has 100% lot coverage?
I'm sure that there are other towns. I mean, I'm sure all of the
I just think it's something that's poor, is not well understood, and we'll see this in the years ahead, that it's gonna look like there's not gonna be any space or trees or ways to walk between these buildings. The wonderful thing just about the Charles Street is that we do have that nice park next to the Charles building, the nice seating area. You won't get that.
Well, do you consider Main Street and Melrose attractive or not?
I'm just asking what the zoning is, and nobody knows whether there's 100% zoning anywhere.
So I appreciate your concern, and I just want to say that any project that's proposed will go through the CPDC, and there'll be a public process, and abutters will be notified, and the public can attend those meetings and have these discussions with an actual proposal to review. So, you know, and it is very common that changes are made to plans after they're submitted and that they don't end up being realized in their initial inception.
Right, okay, I guess this is what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna propose an amendment to the zoning that it become 90% lot coverage, not 100%. It was always 85% and it was moved, a lot of things were changed and made more dense.
I don't think that's within the four corners of this particular
article. That is not within the four corners, no.
Well, if all I've done is raise awareness, then I've done my part tonight. I don't expect to be able to move the needle at this point, but at least people now know what things will look like
sure.
in the years ahead.
And I think we'll probably be discussing the design standards in the future as we move forward.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Further discussion? Yes. Yes.
Jen Cromit, District 3. The only question I have about this is, has there been any consideration on if we do get additional residential, you know, level 2 building coming in, has there been any consideration on what that will mean for parking and space getting downtown?
Well, there are parking requirements, and all of that would be considered in the application as well. Certainly someone who shows up, you know, with a development project that has X number of units and proposes less than the number of parking spaces that we are requiring would have to somehow tell us how they're going to accommodate that.
Okay. Thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. Daddario.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Ron Daddario, Precinct 6. You know, I when I read this, I liked it, and it especially in terms of we'd be able to get that 25% affordable housing and get to count all the units. But you know, I do have a concern when I listening to Mr. Talbot talk that we can actually fill 100% of the footprint, and I know I heard you speak well and say. Well, they go to CBDC and it can change. But a lot of times, if it's stated that they can do it, then it doesn't look like we have a whole lot of leverage if they want to do it and they say, no, we want to do it. It's in our bylaw. So I would say something like this, and I guess I'm remiss in that I'm not well enough, I'm not knowledgeable enough on downtown smart growth to know exactly what can they do and what can't they do. So maybe, let's assume this passes, that maybe you might come back and address some of what Mr. Talbot said, because I don't think anybody here wants 100% coverage of a footprint. Nobody wants that. And I know they've done it in some places, and it's something that none of us want, and we would like not to have to do it. So, but that's not to say, I know you guys are working hard, okay? And I know you put a lot of effort into this thing and you can't think of everything. But anyway, just for maybe the future, you might bring it back and maybe we could address it. Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes.
Thank you, moderator. Nicholas Worth, Precinct 7. I'm new to town meeting, and I just actually want to ask for a chance for you guys to brag about the downtown smart growth district. I don't know anything about how well it's helped the town, how well it's spurred development, and I'd like to ask if you have any quantified elevator pitches for how well this has worked.
Ms. Mercer.
Welcome to town meeting. Since the Smart Growth District was put in place in 2009, there's been one project that's been built, and we have one in the pipeline.
Okay. And, all right. Thank you.
Okay. Further discussion? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? We have a hand. Oh, Ms. Snyder.
Gina Snyder, Precinct 5. So I wanted to be sure I understood. This will expand the existing area with the same design guidelines?
That's correct. As it stands, everything would have to comply with what we have in our design standards right now.
So if one wanted to address Mr. Talbot's concerns, is there some way that different design guidelines could be applied to this new one?
Yeah.
You know, developed with
sure.
the hearings
so
and everything.
In our discussions and our public hearings, when we were considering all of this, we talked about having potentially what they call sub-districts. We're allowed two more sub-districts. So we could, for example, write special rules for that smaller residential area in the Green Street, Ash Street piece, you know, where we thought something different was more applicable.
Do you have any plans for that, or how would that get spurred happen?
We just have to start working on it.
Yeah.
But you don't have anything in the works for that. You thought about it, but you're not. Is that?
We don't have anything in the works, only because we've been extremely busy with other things. Not that it's not a priority.
So could you remind me the design guidelines allow? So my recollection is that the 30 Haven Street development got to be as high as it is because they were only going to put housing. The town wanted some sort of businesses, the real mixed-use concept, to actually happen. So you gave them an extra story as long as they put. So the design guidelines did limit the height, but that was, were they, was that negotiated, or were the design guidelines changed permanently?
No. So the height is limited by the zoning, and anything in the zoning, with the exception of the affordability requirement, can be waived by the CPDC under the right circumstances.
So the design guidelines were...
The zoning was in place before they came with their application. So the zoning requires commercial base, and for that you get some density benefits. You get to build more units than you would normally get to build otherwise. The height is always controlled. It's 45 feet. But let's say they had a really good project, really quality project, and they wanted 46 feet. We could look at that and say, okay, that is not detrimental, and we could waive that requirement. Could ask them to put more green space in if they wanted 48 feet. So we can start doing things like that. But the guidelines also call for things like the setback on that top story so that you're not getting the big mass. And it also calls for the facade of that building to start breaking up after X number of feet. So they can't just run a flat wall. Now the back is facing a parking lot and there are some different requirements there. But again, we can craft additional design standards. These are standards because they are enforceable. They're not guidelines like we might have for South Main Street, where we sort of suggest you do something. These are standards.
Okay. A different question I have for you is, have you considered good old Sanford Street, the issues with the traffic safety that is one of the priority areas that cannot be addressed because it would be so expensive to fix the dangerous intersection there? If somebody came in for that parcel, which looks pretty prime because there's a lot of open parking there, so now we're talking about the southeast corner, quote, triangle sort of shape, what kind of traffic impact could that have if they built to the full allowance of the design standards? And would you be able, if they simply were complying with the design standards, to have the developer do something to modify that intersection so it wasn't so dangerous?
Sure, John, I'll talk about that.
So it's a little bit hard to understand what the traffic impacts of a particular development without having the details of the development. I know when 30 Haven was being developed, one of the concerns was that because Atlantic Supermarket generated so much traffic on one floor, and there was going to be four floors worth of building there, that people were jumping to the consideration that there is going to be four times more traffic. And in fact, what I think probably what everyone has experienced, there's probably one fourth, if not less, the amount of traffic from that bigger building. Huge difference. And it, so it all depends. The reason why I say that is it all depends what the development is. If it's a Dunkin' Donuts, there's tons of traffic. If it's a nail salon, there just isn't that much traffic. So not to put you off, but it's really hard to get into the details until you have a specific development in front of you. Something like 30 Haven was a very unique, you can actually easily pick it out on that map, is because it is so unique of a project. It was a big parcel. The only reason they were able to get 100% coverage was because they had a big enough parcel to be able to use the basement for underground parking. So it's going to be hard for any other site to be able to put enough underground parking with a ramp down and all of that to be able to do that, to have loading zones, because they were able to do that because the public parking lot on back. So there's a lot of that detail of how a particular site works that you would need to get into to figure out how the traffic circulation would work there. I'm sorry.
So is there any situation in which a developer could be imposed upon, shall we say, to do something about the intersection leading into their new development if they were to pick up that parcel?
Yeah, a developer has to do, for any of these, has to do a traffic study. We need to make sure that it's safe, that and if making it safe means doing something to the entrance and to the streets in and around that make it more safe and more workable, then yeah, absolutely.
Well, we would hope that'll happen.
We would not even, not only encourage it, we would require that.
Well, I guess it's worth supporting in the hope that something will end up happening there. Thank you.
Further discussion? Not appearing? Are we ready for the vote? This requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor, please rise. Forty-two. And those opposed, please rise.
Zero.
Three. Zero.
Zero.
I'm sorry.
Zero.
Zero. I'm sorry. The vote being 136 in the affirmative, 3 in the 0, the motion carries.
Point of order.
Point of order.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jonathan Barnes, Precinct 5. I'm inclined to ask, in light of the conversation, in light of the discussion about Article 20 and Article 22, for a motion to reconsider Article 20. I'd like to ask, my understanding is that ought to be done before the adjournment of the session at which that vote was held. What would be the procedure for me to do that, Mr. Moderator?
You could make the motion right now, or you have 24 hours to do it at the town clerk's office.
Thank you. Then before I make that motion, may I also ask then, in light of the fact that Article 20, I can make that motion with respect to Article 20.
Did you vote in favor of the motion?
I did vote in favor of it.
Okay.
I did not vote in favor of Article 22, so perhaps there may be some interest in a motion to reconsider that as well. But my first question is, if there were to be some discussion about that, that might bring into play Article 21.
Discussion would be strictly on why we should reconsider 20. That would be it.
But if we did decide to reconsider, and I don't mean to belabor this, I apologize, yeah. But if we did reconsider, and if that vote changed, that might bring into play Article 21. Would there be a way, is it possible to then bring back Article 21, since that was the article that if Article 20 did not pass, there would be a moratorium period? And I'd be interested in whether there would be an additional ability to do that. I apologize.
It would work the same way. You would have to reconsider the indefinite postponement of that article. That was not defeated. It was indefinitely postponed.
Was it tabled or was it?
It was indefinitely postponed.
Okay. So that would require a motion for reconsideration as well?
Right. Someone that voted in favor of indefinite postponement.
I believe I voted in favor of that. Can I make a motion for that, or would that be after the motion for reconsideration of Article 20?
If you want both of them to come back, you would have to make a motion to reconsider both Article 20 and the indefinite postponement of Article 21.
Then I would do that, please.
You want to make reconsideration of both of those?
Yes.
Okay. That will become the first order of business at the next session.
Thank you.
Before we move on, do you have that recorded? Okay. We have another point of order. Ms. Binder, please use the microphone.
Angela Binder, Precinct 5. If those two were reconsidered, then do we have to reconsider Article 22 also? Does that have to be put into play too? That passed, right? Article 22 passed, right?
It did. It carried,
yeah,
yes.
So if we reconsidered 20 and 21, wouldn't we also have to reconsider 22?
Only if someone makes that motion, correct?
I'm making a motion to reconsider that one too, because we'd
okay.
need to reconsider.
Keep in mind that all of these went through by fairly overwhelming votes, and it requires 2/3 vote to reconsider. Then we would go back into the article.
Okay, I'm just thinking, as long as there's a motion to reconsider 20 and 21, then that should be in play too.
Are you making that motion?
I'm making that motion.
Okay. Next is business under Article 25. Point of order. Excuse me.
Just one second.
Okay. Not for some reason we don't need seconds on those because of the way our bylaw is written. It just made the motion's made and it's recorded with the town clerk. All right. Do we want to move on to 25? It has to be, it doesn't really have to be, because nothing becomes official until 7 days after signee die. But if you want to wait, that's fine with the chair. Mr. Arena. Okay, we have a motion to adjourn until Monday, May 1st at 7:30 p.m. Is there a second? Second. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? The motion carries. This town meeting stands adjourned until Monday evening,